The University of Saskatchewan is located on Treaty 6 territory and traditional homeland of the Métis. All of us are meeting here from different places, within and outside of Canada, to talk about water. Water is the lifeblood of people and societies, connecting us to each other. Wherever you are, please take a moment to acknowledge the Indigenous heritage of the lands where you live and work. We pay our respect to the Indigenous ancestors of these lands and waters, reaffirming our relationship with each other and our desire to have a productive and positive discussion here today together. To begin, I would like to just begin with a few logistics notes for today before we get started. If you would like to listen in French, you can do so by clicking on the globe-shaped interpretation button in the bottom right-hand corner. And there's also English closed captioning available by clicking on the CC button also in the bottom right-hand corner. Today's event will be approximately 1 hour in length, and during the event, participants will remain muted. We would like to offer the opportunity to ask our panelists questions at the end. So if you would like to put your questions in the chat box throughout their conversation, we'll be happy to address those with the panel in the latter part of the discussion. I would like to recognize our sponsors today, the Global Water Futures Research Program, the Global Water Futures Young Professionals, and the Global Institute for Water Security for providing the resources to make the Women in Water Lecture Series possible. An important part of this series is also the young professionals who have taken the time to come and attend today. And in particular, I'd like to recognize those YP who are attending today from the University of Saskatchewan, Laurier, Waterloo, and McMaster. This year, in addition to hosting the lecture series, we are having a Women in Water expert list. And it's an important project that we'd like to launch to be able to find even more ways to highlight the work of researchers working on gender-related water impacts in the field. And if you'd like to be part of this public-facing expert list, we'd like you to indicate your interest by registering for any one of the talks this season, and we'll be able to be in contact with you with more information in the spring of 2022. And so with those introductions out of the way, I'll pass the microphone over to my colleague, Dr. Corin Schuster-Wallace.
Thank you, Andrea, and I'd like to echo the welcome that Andrea has given to all of you. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Corin Schuster-Wallace. I'm a water health researcher here at the University of Saskatchewan. I'm Associate Director of Global Water Futures and founder of the Women on Water Lecture Series. And as a reminder, especially for those of you who might be new to the series, this lecture series was conceived in response to the recognition that we need more opportunities to showcase women researchers in water sciences and research. And we need to provide leadership opportunities for our young professionals. It was also conceived to draw attention to the gendered nature of water and the need to include gender-based analyses in our research. So each of our five lectures between January and March this year focus on specific water-related themes. Last week, we started the discussion with the series with a discussion on transboundary collaboration within the context of women in high mountain waters. Part of that discussion focused on the need to engage within watersheds for better water resources management and for risk reduction, even and perhaps especially because when those watersheds span internal and international boundaries. And depending on jurisdictions, upstream and downstream communities may have different priorities, they may have different governance structures, and so this makes it even more important to share perspectives and solutions. And importantly, downstream communities clearly have a high degree of dependency on upstream water uses and upstream water decisions, particularly within the context of a changing climate. And it also means that there can be disconnects between the benefits which typically accrue upstream, or perhaps even, as we heard last lecture, outside the watershed in the case of hydropower, and the impacts then that often occur in downstream reaches, both in terms of water quality, water quantity, and other impacts that might occur. And so today's structured conversation takes this even further by focusing on innovations in watershed management towards better engagement between upstream and downstream voices. And the conversation last week and research findings, for example, from Bangladesh, really demonstrate the lack of engagement between upstream and downstream communities and the importance of watershed approaches. Inadequate representation of women and other equity deserving groups in water institutions has also been identified as a challenge in many parts of the world. And we've discussed this in previous Women and Water lectures as well. And so this lack of representation also contributes to voices that are missing from watershed engagement and therefore watershed management. And for this and many other reasons, I'm really looking forward to learning more from our speakers today. So Andrea, back to you for introductions.
Thank you, Corin, and thank you to everyone who is joining us today. It's my pleasure to introduce our host, Halayla Belki, our guest, Dr. Deborah McGregor, and Michela Carriere to you before the conversation begins. Layla Belki is the Program Manager for Global Water Futures Integrated Modeling Program, IMPC. She's an early career professional passionate about policy-relevant research for water security and climate resiliency. Layla has studied environmental sciences at the University of Pennsylvania and completed her master's in sustainable environmental management at USASC in 2019, with a collaborative research focus on identifying meaningful Indigenous engagement principles to inform UNESCO's Global Geopark Initiative. Layla believes in and focuses her work on collaborative problem solving and ongoing dialogue to implement effective engagement strategies that connect research solutions with community action and decision making. Dr. Deborah McGregor is Anishinabe and is Associate Professor and Canada Research Chair in Indigenous Environmental Justice at York University. Professor McGregor's research has focused on Indigenous knowledge and legal systems and their various applications in diverse contexts, including water and environmental governance, environmental and climate justice, health and environment and sustainability. And Michela Carriere is an Indigenous adventure guide from Big Eddy Lodge, 60 kilometers northwest of the nearest town, Cumberland House, Saskatchewan. This area is known as the Saskatchewan River Delta. Michela is the owner of Aski Holistic Adventures. Her tours will take you deep into the Canadian wilderness to connect with the natural world, while her traditional skills teaching delves into the practices of Indigenous herbalists to heal your spirit. Michela is joining us today from a satellite internet connection, which may result in a slight delay at times during the conversation. A warm welcome to each of our presenters and our host, Layla. And with that in mind, I'll turn it over to you, Layla, to begin this conversation. And I look forward to chiming back in with questions towards the end.
Thank you, Andrea. Hi, everyone. Thanks, Andrea, both for that introduction, for the invite for me to be part of this today, and thanks for the entire team for putting this webinar series together. Now, because we have a little less than an hour for the webinar portion of this conversation, I'll just dive right into this to some of the questions and get the conversation started. All right, so let's start at the very beginning with processes of engagement. How do you begin the process across a watershed for equitable and for sustainable watershed management? Oh, Michela, I think you might be muted there.
Oh, hi. I've been thinking about this question for some time. Thank you for the introduction. But to begin a process of engagement for, I can only speak from my experience as being like a Indigenous downstream user of the river and the water. I've been involved with the Delta and the water and all the committees and watershed management for about probably 15 years now. And my parents have been involved for at least 40 years. And then, you know, my grandfather and all my uncles and aunties and my grandmother have been involved for, probably 80 years. So we have a long history of trying to engage with the upstream users and the powers that may be that kind of control the, I guess, the water and the management. And so far it's been a very a repetitive process. Like, we've heard the same things over and over again. So I think one thing I would love to see in the future, and maybe it's beginning, but is to actually get everyone together. I mean, this is probably every watershed wants upstream users and downstream and all the different fractions of the community to be together in one room to actually talk about this stuff. That has been the how it's been in the past is they always meet with just small slivers of the community, like just the Métis, just the trappers, or just the reserve, and they've never met with everybody all together so that we can actually come to a consensus. I think in the future, I think consensus is the way to go. We have to engage the whole community, not just fractions, but the whole community, upstream, downstream, all together. And that process is going to take time, but I think that's what we need, is to like really slow it down. You know, we got to like become that little log that's floating on the river. So that's what I have to say to that.
Thank you, Michela. So welcome everyone, and thank you for having me. I am, I would say dialing in, but actually I clicked from Toronto, so Great Lakes. I think what I would do to try to answer the question, because it's pretty big, is just speak to sort of the different kind of, the kind of work that I've been drawn into. That's probably the more accurate word to use. Much like Michela talking about, you know, four decades of her family being involved in engaging in the water that we lived in. For me, it would have been just a way that you grew up. Like, we grew up right by the water, Great Lakes. That's where we got the water. You could fish there. And then the inequity and injustice comes up when I come back from university and then you can't drink the water. Actually, we couldn't, but no one told us. You had fish consumption guidelines, and again, no one really told you. And we really rely on fish in the Great Lakes because they were completely contaminated. So Indigenous peoples were disproportionately impacted by that. And so part of it is informed by lived experience, and knowing that it's important without having to go to school and someone telling you that it is. Then when it became research, because right now I work at York University, and a lot of my engagement is around research, governance, policy, sort of like that scale of working on this, is it was with the Walkerton inquiry. So most of you are probably familiar with that, because that was sort of kind of a big deal in Canada when people died because of contaminated water in southwestern Ontario. But because that was off reserve in provincial area, like under provincial jurisdiction, they really didn't think First Nations were part of the conversation. Fortunately, Justice O'Connor did, and you know, sought submissions from First Nations. And I was asked to work on the traditional knowledge component of the Chiefs of Ontario submission. And when I did that and traveled around Ontario and talked to different elders and knowledge holders and practitioners, they had a very different idea about how water was understood. You know, the big contrast, but also that's where the gendered aspect became really evident. People, women that I met with, they were already organizing, they were already doing this work. It just really wasn't known. They were already advocating for water. They were already engaging in spiritual relationships, ceremonial aspects, trying to heal water. And that's when I first learned about it, and continued to do work around governance and policy. And every time we would finish a project, elders, grandmothers, grandfathers would say, you know, as researchers or policy people always chasing working on projects, they just said, you're never done. Like, we would think we'd be done. We go, whew, like, we finished with that. Boy, met the deadline. Then they would say, no, you're not. Now you have to do something with that knowledge. So the work, it never went away. You know, after decades, it's still there, this continual engagement in different forms. So engagement happens at different levels and different scales, and being able to link the lived experience of people, a people on the ground and how they're experiencing and understand and recognizing that as knowledge and credible and legitimate, that really should be part of decision making, has become a big part of the work that I try to do. Again, a lot of it around Indigenous knowledge scale. We did a source water protection plan, actually water security. The way that I found that elders, what I learned from them was they didn't look at things as source water protection and multi-barrier approach. They looked at it as, how do we take care of our relative? How do we take care of water? Completely different way of approaching how we'd be having a relationship with water. So some of what I do now is advocacy around trying to convey that around other kind of initiatives like, you know, Canadian Water Agency or changes to the Canadian Navigable Waters Act and those kind of things. So yeah, so that's kind of some of the work that I do and how I see how we have to like keep pushing and how research can support policy and advocacy. I don't get to do as much cool stuff as Michela does. I wish I could. So I don't get to spend as much time with and on water as I would like. I'm fiddling around with paper a lot of the time. So thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you both. So Deborah, you mentioned a couple of points there, but I think one that's really nicely leading to another question I have here for you is that gendered aspect of the water management and involvement of community members in some of those initiatives. So let's maybe expand on that a little bit more. Can you provide some examples of gendered impacts across watershed management specifically? And you did talk about one example there, but I'm wondering if you can expand on that a little bit more. I'm wondering if these gendered impacts, do they differ from other inequities? We'll start with you, Deborah, and then maybe Michela, we'll move on to you as well.
I think they do. Like when I think about being in my community and I look out over literally McGregor Bay, weirdly, that's actually the very same place my ancestors would have been for countless generations. I'm literally living on the same water, drinking the same, because you know how the hydrological cycle works. So there's this connection there and this deep level of engagement and responsibility. So that's probably one of the number one things that I learned was the responsibility, this unique responsibility that, and I can't speak for other nations. This is sort of for Anishinabek, like other ones can speak for themselves, but this is the people that primarily told me, you know, that women have a particular responsibility to speak for water. And there's very specific ceremonial work that would be associated with that. And that's what they did. Like that's what the work they were engaged in. They weren't asking for permission from governments. They weren't even asking permission necessarily from First Nations leadership, which still is very male dominated in the Indigenous world. And so they were just realizing those responsibility based on these, you know, thousands of years of knowledge. And that relationship comes from a couple of, sources, for lack of a better word. One is that water is the first environment. Like that's where we live before we're born. And, you know, as far as I know, I could be behind the science. Women for the most part are the ones who give birth. There's that deep connection of taking care of that water for, you know, future generations and how you're going to give birth, but also to the moon. So there's also this connection to the moon as well. And I don't know as much about that as I would like, although I did just have a PhD student who just, that was one of her questions that she was asking people, how does the moon and the moon relate to women and governance? And it's quite, I guess you could say it's actually simple, but also complex. There's a relationship there that's understood. And what makes it, I find, really interesting, that's so different than the way water management and governance is thought about, is you're connecting to future generations, the ancestors, but also to the moon. So these other entities that exist in the natural world, I've never really seen a mainstream, conventional, what I'll call mainstream or conventional watershed plan or source water protection plan that does that. It doesn't. So Indigenous or Anishinaabek conceptions are much broader. So that's a huge responsibility that women have. But through Indigenous knowledge or traditional knowledge, it actually exists and people do know what they need to do to have appropriate relationships with water. So women have distinct knowledge to bring to these processes, but often are excluded from them. I'll stop there so that, you know, I'd like to hear from, you know, Michela and what she thinks of all this. She's from a different culture than I am, so I don't know. Like, I'd like to learn a little bit more about that.
Yeah, you brought up some really good things. What you said to the first question really resonated with me, that fact that we, as Indigenous people, the big work is in legitimizing our knowledge and bringing that to the table, because yeah, there's so much knowledge here, and just because it doesn't have a university degree attached to it doesn't mean it's not valid. It has to be validated and respected amongst all the players. So to speak to gendered impacts, well, I'll just speak to like my experience here. Like where I live, it's quite colonized. The Cumberland House, there's such a deep history. It's like one of the oldest communities in Western Canada. Like it was like, yeah, a big trading place. So colonization is so deep that some of that knowledge of, I guess, in the Indigenous knowledge has been lost, and it's like being rediscovered in modern days. For me, I grew up different than maybe my community because I'm like right on the river. We have no road, so we're always using the river as a place to like travel upon. So we're like witnessing it every day. But as a woman, and this wasn't done intentionally, it's just because colonization is so ingrained, I guess, in, you know, patriotism, or what do you call that when the men are in charge?
Patriarchal.
I was never patriarchal. Yes. Mm-hmm. I was never encouraged or taught from a young age to access the river or to use the river. So for example, like my dad or my brother, they started learning canoeing and how to operate like a motorboat when they're about like 8 years old. And I didn't start learning that until I was like in my late teens, just because there's kind of this this attitude, like protect the women, make sure they're not in dangerous situations. It was always this theme. Even my grandmother was like, you know, make sure you stay home and you keep the fires going, keep the men fed, and like beware, there's wolves out there. Like she had all these different stories. So I think that's a gendered impact. It's like as women we don't have as much access to the water. We're not taught those skills from a young age, and it took me quite a long time until like my late 20s until I discovered that actually I can be a guide. I can be an adventure guide. I can use the river, that it's not just a man's job to be a hunting guide, to be a canoe guide. A woman can do that too. So that was a long journey for me. So I think that impacts women a lot in our area. So there's not a lot of women in leadership roles that can influence like how water is going to be used. I think we have like such a, we have a different perspective too as women, because for some of us, like we're using the water to make food, to like bathe, to bathe our families. So we have to really look at that water not as just transportation, but like as something that we have to consume and make sure that our families are not going to be sick. So I really think that having more women in leadership roles is important in water, because we can bring a whole different perspective than maybe men can. We need both, right, to have this balance. And what you were talking about, the moon, so that's something that's really like really important to me. I'm actually wearing a moon shirt right now, but there's a really close relationship between like the water ceremonies and the moon ceremonies. And the importance of that for me is it actually, I do like a full moon ceremony every month, and it gives me like it renews me, it gives me like power, it sets my intention for the whole month, and it like really grounds me back to like to the water. So I think those spiritual connections to like the moon and to the water are really powerful, because they actually bring confidence to us, especially as women. Like it's really powerful, because I think we're pretty hard on ourselves as women, and we need those ceremonies and that connection to the water and the moon to renew ourselves. And yeah, that's really important. I hope that going forward we can get more women connected to the water in my community. I want to engage more girls in like canoe trips. That's what I'm planning this summer. So I think that's really important that we give access to our women to water through like teaching them how to operate a boat, something like that, or how to, you know, worship the moon, and how to there's different careers in water that they can become part of, and they can become a leader and honor the water that way.
Thanks, Michela. I'm glad that you kind of ended with some action items or suggested ways that we could start addressing some of those problems. And it made me think a little bit about what research projects or what individuals outside a given community who are not as familiar with that local context or with that specific culture of the community, how can they approach some of these gendered impacts or be aware of them and try to address them in one way or the other? So Michela, maybe you can continue with that answer, and then I'll move back to Deborah.
So you want me to talk more about action points?
Possible action points for people outside a community, for example, as research, I work in a research program. So when I visit the community, I'm not always aware of some of those local dynamics that you mentioned, especially around gendered impacts or gender dynamics. So what would be your suggestion or recommendation, or how would you suggest that we can, as outsiders coming in or visiting or working with community members, how can we make ourselves more aware of some of those issues?
I have a quick suggestion just off the top of my mind. It would be nice to do this water conference, but do it here, and I could host it on the river at the Aski Holistic Lodge. We could paddle in. So that's something that we could plan in the future. But I think this is something that my mom has always told me for a long time. As women, we've always been organizing for others. Like we organize for our children, you know, we make their hockey tournaments. We're organizing, you know, childcare so that the men can go to work and go to their meetings and to their sporting things. But what women really need to do is organize for themselves. So that's one thing. As women, we need to like start organizing like adventure trips, canoeing, just going out, taking like ourselves or a group of women, and leaving the childcare to the men. Like we don't even have to organize it. Just let them organize that. Like, oh, hey, we're going, we're packing our bag, we're going to go on a trip to the river, to the water, to the lake, to really get more intimate with it, you know, like fishing trips, like just like going out there and like teaching ourselves, because that's how our men started. Like I've heard stories of my dad just like having no idea what he's doing, just taking the fishing net and going out there and kind of learning as he goes. Like we don't have to know everything before we go out there. We have to actually go out there, organize for ourselves, get closer to the water, see how it's being used, and like see the impacts on the environment, see like people living along the river, what's being dumped in there. Like if you actually travel along the river and the lakes, you'll see what's happening there. So I think that's a big action point, is women organizing for women, these adventure trips.
Thank you. Deborah, do you have anything? And you yourself work in research, so I think that makes it to responses.
Yeah, I just want to, Michela, I would go to the water conference on water and try to convince everybody else if they wanted to go. That sounds like exactly what should be happening. I think engagement has to happen, because water doesn't really do boundaries. Water, that was like sort of what was recognized by Justice O'Connor in the Walkerton, was like, water doesn't just stop provincially and then, you know, stop as soon as you enter into a First Nation and vice versa. So water, so if you follow actually the nature of water, there's going to have to be, you know, engagement and collaboration in order to meet the challenges that that we talked about in terms of upstream and downstream. So I think, to me, probably one of the biggest things in terms of engagement, and it's becoming, I'd say more and more, what would be the word? It's becoming more and more in the radar, I think, for a lot of researchers, because a lot of granting agencies are now saying you must have Indigenous people on your grants and stuff like that, is the huge demands being made on Indigenous peoples without any kind of support for engagement. Like, people want to. It's just they have kind of day jobs, right? And their job isn't like mine, where my job is research, although sometimes I think I hardly get to do it, spend way more time on emails and answering emails than I do actually getting to do research. So I think the engagement has to be at multiple levels and multiple scales. So for example, just building upon what Michela said, like, people are in the community and they're doing things, but people don't know about it. Because for example, like, I really like the idea of being on the water and being on the river. So I think about work that, let's say, the late grandmother Josephine Mondawmin did walking around the Great Lakes. So it's a little bit different, because she's walking around the Great Lakes for the Great Lakes to build awareness, approaching that with a degree of humility. It wasn't about the politics of the day, it was about kind of realizing there's responsibilities and trying to raise people's awareness. How does something like that fit into the academic world, right? Like, me, why go in and study it? People have, what are the reasons for this? But it doesn't mean that we gain the expertise that she did, like walking around the Great Lakes and seeing what she saw, much like Michela talked about. Once you start, you know, you're in your canoe down the river, you're seeing all kinds of things that you don't see in modeling or on a map or anything like that. you just don't have that kind of filter. But at the same time, engagement also has to happen at much higher levels. So when you're creating something like, say, the Canada Water Agency, or there's amendments happening to acts that impact water, that's a whole different kind of level. But somehow trying to figure out how to make sure that the experiential learning, the on-the-ground knowledge, is somehow also feeding into those processes, as opposed to it still being top-down. Because that can also happen in Indigenous communities too. A lot of people may not be aware of these broader processes going on, but they still have a lot to offer. So I think for non-Indigenous researchers, allied researchers, or settler researchers, they have to recognize Indigenous people's reality and respect that, and then figure out what it is that Indigenous people want and need and want to achieve in terms of addressing challenges or finding opportunities. And support that, and being able to support that. I think those are really important, because I'm finding the demands on Indigenous peoples are increasing, but there isn't the accompanying support to enable Indigenous peoples to be able to engage in the way that they would like at all these different kind of multiple scales and levels. So I encourage it, but there's other kind of questions that need to be answered and addressed in order for it to be meaningful and respectful, and ensuring it's actually going to benefit Indigenous peoples in the communities and water, because water doesn't do boundaries like that. So a water can be boundaries, right, like Great Lakes and whatever, but it's going to flow and it's going to impact everyone, if that makes any sense.
No, it does. I think you describe both the process and some of the actions and how that applies to different levels of, whether that's governance or whether that's research, it's the different aspects of the workflow, whatever that is, government or research workflow, of outsiders coming in, or non-settlers come, or settlers coming in, or non-Indigenous researchers coming in. for them to be conscious of all of that, all of those different factors throughout the process of engagement. Did I wrap that somewhat correctly?
I think so. And even engaging in work that Michela does, like it isn't just let's study the question and water is just sort of really abstract kind of thing. It's like literally be on the water, be by the water. Like literally you have to have that kind of experiential, you kind of have to experience it yourself and then you appreciate it in a different way. It's taking water from being so abstract. Like I will do in policy, right? What does the water agency do? It's certainly not talking about relationships at the moon. And so it's very abstract. It's very conceptual. You got to bring it to a level that makes it real. It's more than, what's in people's water bottles. It means a lot more than that. So I think that's probably one of the biggest challenges with engagement. We're using these words, but sometimes we don't mean the same thing. And you're trying to take these conceptual abstract kind of things because you're in a room to something that's actually to something real. Think about the kind of work that Michela does. If that makes any sense, yeah.
Yeah, no, it does. That actually is the perfect link to our next question, which is specifically on that difference in worldviews. So the question has to do with, the question is, how do you bring cultural and spiritual elements into the engagement processes in a watershed-based management context? And how do you go about integrating them across the different knowledge systems? So both of you have mentioned to some of those spiritual ways of thinking or spiritual practices as well. And both of them allude to the fact that water is seen as very different. If you're able to expand on that question. Michela, maybe we'll start with you and then we'll continue on with Deborah. Thank you.
Yeah, I'll have to pass this on. It's a deep question, so I'll let Deborah go first.
Sure, and some of these questions are actually pretty tough questions. So I think the idea really is to have a conversation. So if you need time to think about them or process your thoughts a little bit, absolutely let me know.
Yeah, so there's a number of, so that's a huge issue actually, or I should say a huge challenge. So, and again, it has to do with scale, has to do Indigenous led. That's also the big thing right now. Like what does Indigenous led research kind of look like? So when I think about what we did, so when we would have these meetings around, let's say around the Great Lakes, and actually I'm facilitating one next week on Great Lakes, we always make sure we have water. It opens with a water ceremony, even though government people are going to be there, they're going to have to follow the protocol. We have to do it virtually so that they're aware that we're doing this, and we had them in person. They were also expected to kind of show up and do them then, like recognize that's actually part of our process, part of the conversations around policy and governance. But then how does that fit into, let's say, something like the Great Lakes Water Quality Agreement or something like the Canada-Ontario Agreement or something, right? So in my work, a lot of that is advancing the idea of Indigenous knowledge or traditional knowledge, because that's part of it. What I find in my work, people actually don't know what to do about that. So like it's there, they're like, oh, this thing here, we're pretty cool, we're recognizing this, but what to do about is a whole other matter. So often what I've seen, in Ontario, the Great Lakes Strategy, or I see it written down somewhere, is there'll be a recognition. Like they'll just say, Indigenous people have a spiritual and cultural relationship to water. So it's in this little box with these little bullets, but nobody knows what to do about that. Like, what does that mean then? So there's still massive amounts of education that needs to happen. But so the example that I gave in terms of the water security plan that we did in my community, the ceremonial aspects were built into that plan. So every season, there has to be water ceremony. Like literally it's built into the plan because it's First Nations and it's First Nations led. Anybody can come, like sometimes people from other communities would come. So it actually was built into the plan because it's our plan. Trying to get it into other people's plans is a whole other matter because that worldview doesn't recognize that as being an important part of caring for water or ensuring water is going to be there for future generations, but it's certainly part of the part of the Anishinabek concept of that. So it's very challenging to do it. The other part of the challenge is that when people aren't ready to hear it, it's similar to what Michela said. Indigenous peoples have been saying this for centuries, decades. They've been saying, this is how we understand our relationship to land and to water. It's just people aren't necessarily ready to listen to it because it does require a different way of relating. Like it's a coexistence and a different way of relating to water, and people aren't ready for that. They still want to look at water as being a resource, a commodity, property. You'll see that. Look on any government website, Canada's resources, water resources. It doesn't look at water in the same way that, you know, a lot of different nations would, and it's diverse in how people understand understand water. So there's still that, there's still kind of that disconnect. It doesn't mean that Indigenous people don't have those concepts as well. It's just much broader. Again, that includes the relationship with the moon, because the moon influences the tides. It's so powerful. So it's very difficult to do that. But in terms of the engagement in process, when you're sitting there with people, it can happen. Like, again, like we'll have this meeting and there'll be a water ceremony to open, and there'll be ceremonial aspects at the end. People will be asked to bring water into, you know, but those same people are going to have a hard time. Like, how does this fit into this like agreement? How does this fit into our plans around whatever, right? So they, Indigenous people will know what to do about that. So that's still a big challenge. So it's there, but what to do with it, even though people keep saying this is a whole other matter. And I think there still needs to be a lot of work around, around how do we do that? But it really requires, I would say, non-Indigenous folk, and including even Indigenous folk, because like folk too, is like Michela said, their colonization is, isn't gone. It's not historical, it's ongoing. In terms of, you know, kind of changing the way that you think and relate. And that's really hard to do because we don't educate people that way in the education system. You're probably going to be learning that elsewhere in the kind of work that Michela talked about, or Great Lakes water walks and those kind of aspects. So it's there conceptually in an abstract kind of way, but what you actually do, again, is a whole other matter, I find, in the work that I do. I don't know if that's helpful, Michela, anything you can build off there?
Yeah, well, actually, it's all coming back to me now because I was thinking about this question before. So when I'm thinking of culture, big aspect of culture is language. And one thing I'd really like to see is to have all the waterways named in the languages of the Indigenous people that use them. Because every time you speak an Indigenous language, it invokes the whole history of the people and invokes that connection to them. So if we could actually get rid of all the colonial names and just rename them the actual names that they were given by the people, every time you talk about that watershed and you name the actual name of the river, like what would the name of this river be?
Kisichewan.
If we said that every time we were talking about the Saskatchewan River, the you would always be thinking of how are Indigenous people involved. This is, and you have a respect for them, you have a respect for their culture. So I think that's a huge piece that should be looked at and that we have to bring into is dismantling that whole system of the colonial language and putting in our own languages so that when we talk about water, it's always directly linked to Indigenous people.
Thanks for that point, Michela. Those are incredible points. And some of these really are, I think, very, very theoretical. So I absolutely understand if you needed time to think about some of these questions a little bit more. One of the things I was just thinking about was how some of our audience in these webinar series, if I understand right, happen to be a global audience too. So I think one question that I kind of want to pose is this idea of community engagement, but how it is different in a non-Indigenous and an Indigenous context. So thinking of the more global audience, again, defining Indigenous people, for example, for a global audience, that's another complicated question. So keeping that keeping the fact in mind that some of the audience may be coming from different countries, are you able to, Deborah, maybe we'll start with you. Are you able to maybe attempt to differentiate the two there?
It's a good question because it's the reality that we're dealing with. And again, when, especially when you're operating at a large scale and scope in terms of the work that you're doing, which is pretty well almost anything to do with policy and governance, right? So how do you engage? I do think the engagement differs because of who you consider to be experts, who's considered to be able to contribute to the whatever process of engagement is. You're developing a watershed plan or a high level policy, provincial or regional, whatever kind of level. So there's certain people who are considered to be experts. So for example, even just building off of what Michela said, some people might want me to be part of a process because I'm in a university, but I don't speak the language. You're going to miss all this knowledge, thousands of years of knowledge that I'm not going to have because I'm not a fluent speaker, but a fluent speaker you need to have there because they're going to understand the rivers and whatever it is we're talking about in a different way than I ever could. So I think in Indigenous context, automatically we're engaging. So when you're engaging in ceremonial work and spiritual work in these processes, you're also engaging the ancestors. Generally, they're calling them into that conversation. And I've never seen that in others. In the academic world, that would be the peer review, right? But that doesn't go far back enough. So you're engaging at a whole, like you're engaging with the non-human world in the Indigenous engagement. Like non-human in the sense of it being living and having agency and influencing, and there's a relationship there through the clan system or whoever that varies across the country. I don't really see that in I show up to a webinar for some water initiative somewhere. Nobody's talking about that. Nobody does that. Nobody thinks about that. Even though I think for a lot of everyone's going to have some kind of relationship to water, even if it's a bad one or an unacknowledged one, right? Because we're mostly water. We have to drink it in order to survive. I think if we can get people to understand that they actually do have one, what kind of relationship do they want? Get people to be a bit more self-reflective about that kind of relationship. Do they care about future generations? What's going to be there for them? So to me, there's going to be commonalities because water is global, right? Like water is ocean, water is most of the planet is water. So it kind of connects us in a way. It connects us as people, but also connects us directly to water itself. But I find engagement in an Indigenous context is quite different, but it can also look similar. So I can go to, let's say in Ontario, it's the Ontario First Nations Technical Services Corporation. They're the ones who bring together the water treatment operator people a couple times a year, who tend to mostly be men, by the way, which is fine, but they're starting to have more and more women who are in these positions of taking care of water and taking care of the community essentially. So that can look very conventional, so it can still look very conventional, but the conversations would be quite different. When the two of them come together, that could be interesting. And like I've said, like I've facilitated meetings like that, Indigenous people, if they're setting the agenda, will include the cultural and spiritual aspect. That they'll also talk about treaties. We'll also talk about what our responsibilities and our authority and our jurisdiction is in relation to water, because that's actually where our obligations flow from. It doesn't flow from federal or provincial legislation. It actually flows from our own from our own knowledge, from our own laws, from our own governance, that's where our source is. So that needs to be talked about so people understand that we're actually coming from a different place, even though we're engaging in this conversation around policy or governance or watershed planning or management or development, if that's somehow helpful or makes sense. I'm just drawing on, thinking about the work that I'm doing and work I'm going to be doing over the next couple of weeks. And that's the space I kind of find myself in.
Michela, I'm just curious, did you have anything to add on this? I'm happy to repeat the question as well if you wanted to think about that a little bit more.
Yes, repeat the question again.
Sure. So we were just talking about how the process of community engagement might differ in an Indigenous context versus a non-Indigenous context. And I thought this question might be actually very helpful to some of our participants who may be from other countries. That distinction isn't always made very clear.
So I guess Indigenous engagement to me is, it's a lot more like I would say slow process. We really need to slow things down and really engage everybody. There's just like, I feel like when you're in an Indigenous community, there's a different time zone that you're in. And I feel like for us, the upstream users of the river are like on this really fast clock, and they just like, their consultation is always like, oh, we'll give you 30 days to talk about this. But it's not enough time because you have to engage everybody in the community. They need to slow down and actually talk to all the people that are using this river. So I feel like, yeah, Indigenous engagement needs to be, yeah, a much slower time frame because, yeah, the, like you said before, the water has no borders. So it's flowing everywhere, all these different communities, and it takes time to get there too. And so that's what we need to model with engagement, is like we have to really slow it down. Yeah, what do you call that when you have to get everybody to agree? Consensus. It has to be a consensus process. And I think that's a lot of, if you go back to the past or even today in Indigenous societies, it's based on a consensus model. It's based on a circle. It's based on, you know, the matriarchy, like getting women involved. So it's a much slower process when you do it that way, but it gives time for to actually think about the impacts. If you're going to be putting a hydro dam in, if you're going to be utilizing the water for potash or whatever it may be upstream, you have to take the time to really think about what's the impacts that's going to be downstream. And for all the people that use this water, everyone should take time to make those big decisions. And I think, yeah, the Indigenous engagement means to really slow down. We have to take our time to use the water because it impacts everybody, and it impacts the global world. Like my dad was saying about, he's just sitting over here, about the language, the Cree language, when you're talking about even the word, the Cree word for ocean, which was Kichigamiku, mm-hmm. Or is that Lake Superior?
You call it both, actually, Lake Superior.
Yeah, it's a word that's like, it's not just a word that's describing a body of water, it's describing how it belongs to everybody, it's sacred, it crosses many different borders and like tribes, so it's like, it's a bigger perspective in a way, the Indigenous engagement. It's like you have to take a look at the big picture, how it's going to affect people in the community, in the next generations. It's a more slow process.
Mm-hmm. Right. I think the way I've thought about that before, just in our project work as well, is for our work to be more process oriented rather than outcome oriented, which is how typically some of the institutional processes or the way Western or scientific paradigms think of in that way. It's very agenda oriented, meeting oriented, and deadline oriented. So it's very much outcome oriented. And whereas with Indigenous engagement, it's a lot more process oriented, where we're focusing on relationship building, trust building, and just the recognition there that all of that take a lot of time to develop. So we actually have a question from the audience. There is one more question that I did want to touch on, because I personally am very, very curious, and then maybe we'll get to Erin's question in the Q&A box. But one of the things, Deborah, you mentioned early on was the fact that there's always expectation for Indigenous peoples to have to engage in dialogues and have to explain a lot of things from their perspective. And, you know, every time there's a process that's done, there's always more to do. One of the things that I hear a lot from within our project, some of the feedback we get from community members is, you know, there's always dialogue, of course, is incredibly important for everyone's voices to be heard, for different perspectives to be heard. But often dialogue, it stops there. How do we move from dialogue to action, especially in a water management context?
I think it's to make sure, just again, building on what Michela said, the consensus building, like everybody should be involved in making these big decisions, right? So when there's a water management plan, or when we were doing source water protection or water security, the actions that are going to protect water or enable a particular kind of relationship with water have to include everyone. And I don't mean everyone show up at the chief and council meeting, because that'll just become unwieldy, but that there's things for the kids to do, that there's things for the youth to do, there's things for the traditional and the spiritual people to do, there's things that everybody can do. It's not just, these are the people who have whatever their certification from whatever water treatment, whatever, which is critically important, because all kinds of First Nations don't have clean drinking water, they can't drink water, so that's critically important. But there needs to be like a plan that involves and enables action by everyone, not just certain groups of people are going to get together and make decisions and then just consult or try to get input from other people and then go ahead and make the decision. So there's got to be things that everyone could do, and that's possible to do. Like how do you get engaged with two-year-olds? Like in ours, they would do, in the plan, they would do little water walks. They literally know where the drinking water is going to come from, because now it's part of a distribution system, right? Do they know that? So they do little walks to where the intake is. So there's ways to involve. We just don't leave it to certain people who are typically thought as being the decision makers, and they're important. Then I would not say that they're not. Somebody has to be accountable and responsible, but those actions have to include everybody, and things that people can do. I find that's more effective to kind of get water being less abstract and conceptual, and not just in the head, but also in the body, and the way that you think, and the way that you behave. And I think that's also possible for non-Indigenous communities, and I'm starting to see it more, the on the ground activism, or people like non-Indigenous people started to participate in these water walks, and then they would sort of have their own. So they were starting to get it. They were starting to know, like, I am made out of water. Maybe there's something to learn here. Like, I'll appreciate rather than like appropriate, because that's a whole other issue. You know, and start to recognize that these actions have to be something that everyone can be involved in. That would be, to me, probably the major piece of advice, just to take it away from just certain people are going to make decisions, to everyone needs to be part of that. And there needs to be something for everybody to do, not just certain actions that pretty well that are going to be on people, as opposed to actually involve them and enable for them to be able to act. I think that's probably one of the experiences that I found that were really that was really important.
That is absolutely a fantastic place to stop this portion of the conversation. It's so difficult to interject, because you've made such wonderful points. And just before we close the formal portion of the conversation, I just wanted to read one comment that was put in the chat from Nicole Salt, which it says, when names of rivers are spoken in Indigenous languages, the rivers recognize those words as the words of their relatives, the same with the land. And I think that comment really speaks, you know, to your points, Michela, about the importance of why we need to do that. And the other question that we have, and I don't know if either of you would feel comfortable speaking to this, is, can you please explain the water ceremony process? Yeah, obviously, that's probably a very long question, but is there something that you would like to share about the water ceremony process?
I can share a little piece. I don't know about like the larger water ceremonies. There's many different types of water ceremonies, but for us, for me in our community here, we have this really kind of small water ceremony that we do. And it's whenever we start the day and we're on a canoe trip and we're going to be utilizing the water, or even going for a fishing trip, if we're utilizing the water, we actually take a sacred plant. So be that cedar, or some people use tobacco, sweetgrass. Sometimes it could just be a branch of willow, and you take that that plant and you actually say a prayer. You set your intention for the day, and you actually talk to the river as if it's a, because it is a living, breathing entity, and you ask permission to use the water, you ask it to protect you, and you just have a conversation with the water, you and the water alone, and you give that offering to the river. And it's a really nice way to start start the day, to start your journey, to start any kind of conversation, because it sets that intention, it makes that relationship real, it brings life to the river, to the lake, wherever you're traveling. It's that's just one of the small water ceremonies that we do over here.
Thank you so much.
I was just gonna add to that. I agree with Michela. They're really different. Like the water ceremonies that I've been part of have been but have been different, but similar to what Michela said, the intention is always there. Water is present. Like, you can't always be near the water, so sometimes, like I said, we'll do this virtual thing, and we'll be asked to bring a, everyone will be asked to bring a glass of water, and because it's virtual and people are all over the place. But when we would have meetings, we would always try to have it by water. So in a First Nation, or if we're going to talk about the Great Lakes, it's always going to be around water. So it's a little bit easier to acknowledge the water in the way that Michela talked about. And yeah, so that offering for water is really important. That intention in whatever way kind of makes sense, for you. Some people will sing, they'll have their drum there. And partly it's to, the other thing, water, that we didn't talk about so much that I learned doing this work, is water can also take life if you don't respect it. So you need to be able, you need to respect water. And that's one of the ways that you show respect for water itself, but also for the other beings and entities that also live in the water. You're also acknowledging them too, if you're wanting safe passage or like, so there's a lot to this. I don't generally lead them. I'm generally part of them, but that's something that I do myself. In fact, I look kind of weird because I do triathlons, and I'd be like doing this offering before anybody went in the water before our race for the swim part, because we didn't go in the water swimming, because water isn't like for frolicking around in. You're supposed to respect water. So if we're going to do that, then I'm trying to make sure like, that it's going to be safe for everybody. And this is what's going to be happening. So I try to let water know that's what's going to be happening. Even though I'm sure other people think that's kind of weird, this weird thing this woman is doing over there. But I do it. I do it because that's just sort of how I think about my relationship with water. That doesn't matter where I am, that's what I would do. Doesn't matter where I travel, that's what I do as well too. I'm always looking for the water. Good question.
Well, thank you so much. This has been an absolutely wonderful discussion. And I know we're a little bit 5 minutes over, so we will have to end the formal portion of the program here. And if you're one of the Global Water Futures Young Professionals, you're welcome to stay on. And we will shortly just transition this from the webinar and unmute you so that you're able to continue the conversation with Leila and Michela and Deborah. But thank you so much to everyone who has attended today, to all of the folks who have participated in making this event possible, Fred Ryben, Lori and Yolande, Corin Schuster-Wallace, and all of the other Global Water Futures folks who have contributed to this day.